Hey everybody, you know what this is. This is a Q&A with Dr. J Dunn of My Happy Genes, and I do regular Q&As on all different topics. This month we're focusing on foods. We've done three. If you've missed any of them, just check on the YouTube page. They're all there for you. We're going to do alcohol today, which is in fact a food. Many people forget that wine and beer, and if it has calories, it counts as food. So, on that note, talk to us about alcohol and
Well, that's bad
genes.
news.
Oh, wait, I hate to start on bad news.
They aren't throwaway calories. Come on.
My friend Sam always says, if you drink champagne standing up, you don't take in any of the calories. They just burn off.
That's
So
so smart.
I know,
Yeah.
right?
Yeah. So there are some genetic variants that will create big problems for certain people when they drink. Asian population is case in point, and they have a genetic variant where alcohol converts to an aldehyde, and then the aldehyde can't get out of their body. Aldehydes are very toxic, and for them, it causes a flush. They call it the Asian flush when they drink. So a very low rate of alcoholism in that population in general. It's not all of them, but it's a high occurrence rate in the Asian population. And I just happen to get that gene. Thank you very much, mom and dad. Come from a long line of alcoholics, but I can't drink. It just makes me so sick. And very quickly, I'll get a headache. So unfortunately, I got that one. And some people are really good at clearing alcohol. My stepdad, he could drink all night long and not ever look or act drunk and then wake up in the morning all perky and ready to go.
There was just an article in the New York Times 2 days ago about super clearers. They interviewed a bunch of people. Many of them were young, so maybe they had that on their side. But one guy drank a bottle of vodka, a six-pack of beer, and he lost count of how many shots. And he was up at 6:30 running the next morning while his friends were all like, and they just said they don't understand it. Even genetically, they haven't been able to pinpoint what is different about those people.
Yeah, I would guess that that he has all greens in the aldehyde dehydrogenase category, and that his liver is high functioning and he can clear that out. And it depends on the type of alcohol. Again, we discussed wine and how it has sulfites in it and is fermented. And for people that have the TPH gene, it's going to cause problems because it's contraindicated for that gene. Especially red wine. Generally, they can handle white wine. So it's specific on what alcohol they do best with. I wish we don't have a slider for exact types of alcohol. We do have a category of alcohol where you can see, oh, am I a good clearer or am I one of those people? Just one drink and that's it, all I can take. And I'm hungover. But if you switched maybe to a type of alcohol that is more compatible with your genetics, you'd probably be better off. So we differentiate between if you have the fermentation issue that we talked about, you might want to stay away from beer and wine because they're more fermented. And let's say tequila or vodka or something that's more distilled, there's still fermentation there, but not quite as much. And that can do better for you. I'm not advocating, hey, everybody get drunk and find the right alcohol, because alcohol is detrimental to the body. There's just no doubt about it. The science is very strong that it's going to cause damage. People are going to drink, and that's just a real thing. And drinking the thing that is more compatible with your genes is probably a really good idea. I don't think it's a good idea to drink every day. It's really going to backload your enzymes that can get rid of alcohol and create more problems. But it's a touchy subject in that way.
And it's a touchy subject because even though you have read science that said it is definitely 100% there's detrimental going on, there are other scientists that still hold that a glass a day of red wine is heart healthy. And just recently, that whole debate was gone over again in something I was reading. And so we will confirmation bias. I like wine. I'm going to read those guys over there. You're like, oh, yeah, it's bad for us. And I
Right.
agree that it probably isn't good for us on some level. But I also think in moderation, life is life. We celebrate that kind of thing.
No, I see both sides of that argument, and red wine would trash me, but I'll have a glass of white wine once in a while that's sulfite free and I feel okay. And it's fun. There are genetic variants that can lead to alcoholism very readily, though, on the other side of this discussion. And if you have those genetic variants, it can lead to like one drink is going to lead to another. And that's a big problem. So for these people, we do get their brain chemistry balanced so that they don't crave alcohol. And that's one of the things that I'm really passionate about, is getting the brain balanced so that our dopamine levels are sufficient to where we're not craving things and we're not addicted. We've been very successful with all kinds of addictive tendencies and addictive substances in getting people off of them. They would report, I just don't even, it doesn't even sound good anymore. And so if you're craving alcohol, it means you're out of balance. It isn't like your willpower is busted. It can
Right.
mean that your biochemistry is off such that when you drink, it is self-medicating. You're trying to balance your brain with a substance that increases dopamine temporarily, but then it's going to decrease it and it can lead to addiction. It's nice to be in that happy zone where you can have a drink once in a while and you can go, that's enough. Just one for me or just two. But if you find yourself like, oh man, I can't stop once I start, or I think about it all the time, or I'm craving it, there's a lot you can do. And there's a lot that we have done with MyHappyGenes to balance the brain chemistry so that we don't end up in that state.
What a gift that would be for a lot of people.
Yeah, that's why I'm so passionate about this, because it can do that. And I've seen it with methamphetamines, I've seen it with cocaine, I've seen it with alcohol, I've seen it with cigarettes and gambling and on, where we get the brain balance and these habits just fall away. With overeating, with craving sugar, same. That's a symptom. And we have a tendency to beat ourselves up. What's the matter with me? Why can't I just control myself? Why don't I have willpower? And I hope that gives people a little bit of compassion and understanding and the desire to get their genes tested and get their brains balanced so that they can stop this vicious cycle of addiction and craving.
Because body chemistry is stronger than willpower. I hate
Oh
to tell
man.
people. It is.
It's stunning. And I did not know that would happen. And it was a shock to me when I started using the nutrients to balance the brain that I saw people just drop these bad habits and they're like, yeah, doesn't even sound good anymore. And I used to crave it all the time, and it's stunning.
It really is. For people that don't have an alcohol craving or think, why is chemistry stronger than willpower? I don't have to eat a chip. Have a bad night's sleep or a couple of them in a row, your brain is going to send out hyper signals for sugar in the form of carbs or whatever. And I bet you find, I'm not a snacker, but man, do I need a piece of chocolate or whatever. That's a simple example, but it's the same thing. It's just that some people have a gigantic craving in relationship to whatever is going on in their biochemistry.
And some people have iron willpower. It's a very small percentage of people that can quit. If they're alcoholic, they can quit and stay off. And it takes a great deal of willpower. But if your biochemistry is balanced, so much easier. So
It's
much.
like a helping hand.
Yeah, for sure. And then the willpower is much more powerful and can get you over that hump.
Because, of course, it is going to take some of the person showing up and having the desire. I want
Right.
to have this be different in my life.
And taking themselves out of situations where it's going to lead to drinking, and they know it's going to, is drinking, and it's, yeah. So it's a complicated topic, but I really truly believe that getting your biochemistry balance is the first step. If you're fighting that and you're fighting your social scene and your family history, and your family history has told you that's the only way to have fun is by drinking, it's a hard road if you've got all of those things beating you down with alcohol.
It's got to be cocktail hour somewhere in the world. I think I'll be going now.
Well, on another note, my mother, completely balanced at 97, she had to have her martini, her vodka martini at 5 o'clock every night.
That's funny.
That was her reward. And I teased that she slid into home plate with a martini glass in her hand and didn't spill a drop at 97. She looked forward to it. And that was it. One, done. It wasn't like she was addicted. It was just a happy time for her memories.
Oh.
I didn't want to take it away from her because I think that would have killed her.
And she might have killed you.
You're right. She would have killed me.
All right, people, this has been fun. If you have a topic you'd like us to do a Q&A on, please let us know. Email info@myhappygenes.com or leave it here in the chat below the YouTube video. And we'll be back with another Q&A on food. Thanks, Dr. J.
Thanks, GC.